We're asked to find the domain of f of x divided by g of x, f of g of x, and g of f of x. We also want to express the domain using interval notation. So we'll do these one at a time. Let's first start with the quotient of f and g. So f of x divided by g of x. Well, f of x is 2 divided by the square root of x. And g of x is x squared minus x minus 6. We're going to have several restrictions on the domain, so let's keep track of those over here on the side. Let's first talk about the restrictions based upon the square root of x here. We know x can't be negative because the square root of negative is not real, but notice if x is equal to 0, we'd also have division by 0. So right away we know that x has to be greater than 0. And now let's look at the denominator. We know x minus 6 can't equal 0, because if it did, we'd have division by 0. So let's find the values of x that would make the denominator equal to 0, and then we'll exclude those values as well. Well, this factors nicely. The factors of negative 6 that add to negative 1 are negative 3 and positive 2. So the values of x that make this product equal to 0 must be excluded. Well, 3 would make x minus 3 equal to 0, so x can't equal 3. And negative 2 would make x plus 2 equal to 0, so x also can't equal negative 2. So let's see if we can graph our domain, and then we'll write the domain using interval notation. Looking at our restrictions, we know x has to be greater than 0, but it also can't equal 3. So we'll have to have an open circle on 3, open circle on 0, so we'll have the interval from 0 to 3, and then from 3 to positive infinity. Notice we don't have to worry about x not equaling negative 2, because negative 2 is not greater than 0. So the domain of our quotient function will be the open interval from 0 to 3, and then the open interval from 3 to infinity. Now let's find the domain of f of g of x on the next slide. Before we find our composite function, let's review how to find the domain of a composite function. The domain of f of g of x must contain the restrictions of g of x, the inner function, and the restrictions of the composite function. So we'll start by determining the restrictions from the inner function, find the composite function, and then find any other additional restrictions. So f of g of x can be written using this notation here. So g of x is our inner function. Let's keep track of our restrictions over here on the side. Well, g of x is a quadratic function, and the domain of a quadratic function is all real numbers. So there's no restrictions we have to worry about for the inner function g of x. So we'll go ahead and find our composite function and see if there are any other restrictions. So to find our composite function f of g of x, we're going to replace g of x with x squared minus x minus 6, which will give us f of x squared minus x minus 6. And this becomes the input into function f, so we'll substitute this quantity in for this x here. So we'll have 2 divided by the square root of x squared minus x minus 6. So the domain of our composite function will be the domain of this function here, since there were no restrictions for the domain of g of x. Well, we know we can't have division by 0, and we also know that the number underneath the square root can't be negative. So the restriction that we have is that x squared minus x minus 6 must be greater than 0. So the domain will be the solution to this quadratic inequality. So to solve this, we'll determine what x values make this equal to 0, and then we'll form intervals to see which intervals satisfy this inequality. So we're going to solve x squared minus x minus 6 equals 0, which we already factored on the previous slide. It's x minus 3 times x plus 2, so x equals 3 and x equals negative 2 would be the values that make this equal to 0. So now we'll draw a number line. Because this can't equal 0, we'll make open circles on 3 and negative 2. So now we'll pick test values in each interval to see which satisfy the original inequality. So for this interval here, let's go ahead and test 0. Well, if x is 0, we'd have 0 minus 0 minus 6. Negative 6 is not greater than 0. Therefore, this interval is false. Let's go ahead and check, let's say x equals 4. We'd have 16 minus 4, that's 12, minus 6, that's positive 6. Positive 6 is greater than 0, so this entire interval is true, meaning it would be part of our domain. And let's also go ahead and test, let's say, negative 3. Negative 3 squared is 9, minus negative 3 would be plus 3, or 12. 12 minus 6 equals 6, which is greater than 0. Therefore, the interval on the left here is also part of our domain. So this is approaching positive infinity. This is approaching negative infinity. So the domain of our composite function would be from negative infinity to negative 2, not including negative 2, as well as the interval from 3 to infinity. And the interval is open on 3. And now for the last question, we want to find the domain of g of f of x. We'll go ahead and write this using this notation here. And because we have a composite function, we first need to consider the restrictions on the domain of the inner function, or in this case, f of x. Let's go ahead and keep track of our restrictions. Let's go ahead and take a look at our inner function, f of x. We have 2 divided by the square root of x. Well, we know x can't be negative, but it also can't be 0 because we have division by 0, which means x must be greater than 0 to begin with. Now we'll find our composite function and see if there are more restrictions on the domain. So this is equal to g of f of x is equal to 2 divided by the square root of x. And this becomes the input into function g. So we'll substitute 2 divided by the square root of x here and here. So we'll have 2 divided by the square root of x squared minus 2 divided by the square root of x, and minus 6. Let's go ahead and simplify this. We'd have 4 divided by x minus 2 divided by the square root of x minus 6. We've already said x has to be greater than 0. Notice our composite function does not add any additional restrictions for the domain, and therefore our domain is going to be x is greater than 0. So if we were to graph that, of course it would look like this. Approaching positive infinity. So the domain of g of f of x is from 0 to infinity, not including 0. I realize these problems can be fairly involved, so I hope these explanations were helpful.